Welcome to Asia's IS Institute. Looking at current affairs for 30th May, the news items picked up from the Hindu newspaper are these 13. We look at them in detail. The first one, GDP growth slows to a 11-year low of 4.2%. Quarter 4 slumps to 3.1%. So economic growth has slowed down to an 11-year low of 4.2%. So this has happened in 2019-20 according to the provisional estimates released by National Statistical Office. So the final quarter of the fiscal year as such means the fourth quarter. The year is divided into four quarters. The fourth quarter is from Jan to March. The financial year begins on 1st April. So in this final quarter of the fiscal year from Jan to March 2020, GDP growth came down to 3.1%. So the overall economic growth for 2019-20 is 4.2%. The fourth quarter growth of 3.1% is actually the slowest in 44 quarters. However, it was still faster, it is said, than what was expected. Agriculture and mining output actually were good. Agriculture, mining sector saw in the fourth quarter growing at a rate of 5.9% and 5.2% respectively. But manufacturing sector actually went in the negative at minus 1.4%. Public administration, defense and other services also grew. They grew at a rate of 10.1%. So agriculture and services in mining were the saviors which brought at least GDP to 3.1% in Q4. GDP actually in 2018-19, a year earlier, this 1920 is 4.2, a year earlier it was 6.1%. And it is said the most disturbing news is that three components of demand have fallen. That is, consumption demand has slowed, investments have slowed, and even exports are in the negative territory. And also experts say that it has to be remembered that this is happening in a year before COVID-19. Because the lockdown started on 25th March, 24th, you can see COVID-19 lockdown, and this is till 31st March 2020. So you can see this is data prior to COVID-19. Economy has gone down. Here you can see this is the real GDP growth and nominal GDP growth shown in blue and red respectively, and how it has fallen in the fourth quarter. What is real and nominal GDP? We'll see that also. So nominal GDP is actually value at current prices. So there's no adjustment for inflation undertaken in nominal GDP, while real GDP is adjusted for inflation. So it is at constant prices. So means because inflationary trends have to be removed to get a real understanding of how GDP has grown. So that is nominal and real GDP. You should know that. So here you can see the red line is real GDP. Sorry, nominal GDP, which is high, but when you adjust it for inflation, it goes down. So this is 3.1% real GDP. Then next is lockdown 5.0 to be strictly implemented in 13 cities. So the government is all set to announce lockdown 5.0 for 2 weeks now, because lockdown 4.0 ends on 31st March. So now this lockdown 5.0 is set to be strictly implemented in 13 cities. We had seen these 13 cities yesterday too, which includes Mumbai, Thane, Pune, Delhi, and even Tamil Nadu, three cities from Tamil Nadu, including Chennai, Jaipur, etc. So these cities have recorded 70% of the total COVID-19 cases, and lockdown 5.0 will be strictly implemented here as such for 2 weeks. Here you can see this is how India ranks 9th in the number of confirmed COVID-19 cases. But the infections as a proportion of its population are much lower compared to other countries. So overall tally, India becomes 9th. So here you can see the most affected countries are shown here. So here lies Russia, Italy. But this is, you can see, tests per million conducted. And this is cases per million. So number of cases per million are high. You can see US has conducted most tests. Then comes Spain, Italy, Russia. And India has conducted very less tests, and it lies here. Then next is, states show variation in testing contacts. So states which are grappling with highest burden of COVID-19 cases have seen least testing of contacts of persons who have confirmed, who have been confirmed as positive of COVID-19. So this is actually a study conducted on nearly 1 lakh individuals by a core group of ICMR scientists and independent epidemiologists. So large proportion of both those who were tested and those who were found positive were asymptomatic. asymptomatic family contacts means they were people who were family members of the person who was tested positive and they were asymptomatic. So large proportion of them were asymptomatic means they were not showing any symptoms, but when tested they turned out to be positive. Kerala, it is said, is among the states that have confirmed, that has contained the pandemic, and it has tested an average of 40 contacts per confirmed positive cases. Means if one person is confirmed positive of COVID-19, then 40 of his contacts on an average have been tested. So that is a very high figure. Maharashtra has tested only 8 contacts. Gujarat has tested only 12 contacts. So then if testing of contacts takes place, then if they come positive, they can be put under, under quarantine, and steps can be taken to treat them so that they do not spread the infection further. So testing contacts and isolation is a critical aspect of restricting fatalities and ensuring that infection does not spread rapidly. Also, another aspect which has been studied is the attack rate. Means based on the number of positive cases per million population, attack rate means fatality has been highest among those aged 50 to 69 years at 63.3%. And is lowest amongst the children as such, those aged under 10 years at 6.1%. As on 29th May, India has 1.65 million people who have tested positive, which is the highest in Asia. So here you can see number of contacts tested have been very low. Here you can see in Maharashtra, Gujarat, Madhya Pradesh, and this is Andhra Pradesh. Here lies West Bengal. This is Haryana. So here the this is Punjab. So here the number of testings have been very low, and green have been more than 75 contacts. So that is that. Then next is JNU students and activists, student and activist Natasha Narwal charged under UAPA. So UAPA is Unlawful Activities Prevention Act. So this is a JNU student and activist who is associated with the Women's Student Collective, Pinjra Tod. She has been arrested on 29th May for her alleged role in communal riots in Northeast Delhi in Feb 2020. So Delhi High Court, we saw yesterday news that it had said that Delhi police investigation is seeming to be targeting only one group of people in the communal violence, and the other side has not been investigated, and asked Delhi police to ensure fair investigation. And the next day it arrested, you can see, Natasha Narwal, who is a JNU student. She is the 7th person to be booked under the UAPA and the stringent law which is there. And she is allegedly involved in violence which happened during NTCA protests at Daryaganj. So what is this UAPA, Unlawful Activities Prevention Act? And it has also been amended in 2019. So we'll see what is it all about. So under the Act, central government may designate an organization as a terrorist organization if it commits or participates in act of terrorism, prepares for terrorism, promotes terrorism, or is involved in terrorism. So here what is important is the term terrorism is not clearly defined. Even internationally it is not. At United Nations also there is a comprehensive convention on terrorism, which India itself has proposed but has not been accepted, because the term terrorism, would be called as terrorism, is not universally acceptable to all. So that is the problem, because even US also has activities in other countries. So whether they also, if you have a definition, and then the such acts also can fall under the category of terrorism. So that vagueness is there. So term terrorism as such is not clearly defined. So here you can see, even if you are preparing for terrorism or promoting terrorism, so these are vague terminologies actually. So it empowers the central government to designate individuals as terrorists also on the same grounds. So organizations can be called terrorist organizations and individuals can be called terrorists. So this is the amendment which has been done in 2019. Means if the government feels you are preparing also for terrorism or promoting terrorism, can be designated as a terrorist. And this is designation by the government, means it has not been proved in the court of law, after which you are designated as a terrorist, but the government is empowered that it designates you as a terrorist. So this is the power under UAPA Act. Also under the Act, investigating officer must obtain prior approval of Director General of Police to seize property that may be connected with terrorism, and if the investigation is conducted by officer of NIA, the approval of Director General of NIA is mandatory. And under the Act, investigation of cases may be conducted by officers of rank of DSP or ACP or above. And NIA can also investigate. So this bill has actually been passed. It has become an act. So here you can see the law allows NIA to go to any state without taking permission from state police concerned for checking anti-terror activities. So this is there. Then next is Major Suman Gawani chosen for UN award. So Major Suman Gawani of the Indian Army, who has served as a woman peacekeeper with United Nations mission in South Sudan in 2019, has been selected for the prestigious UN Military Gender Advocate of the Year award. So Major Suman Gawani, she has received the award through a online ceremony as such on 29th May, which is International Day of United Nations Peacekeepers. And she has been a military observer, and she was the principal focal point of contact for gender issues for military observers in the mission, in the UN mission in South Sudan. She encouraged participation in joint military patrols to maintain gender balance irrespective of the hardships and extreme field conditions. She also strived to integrate gender perspective into planning and military activity in the mission. And she demonstrated how gender perspective can help in protecting civilians, especially in conflict related social violence, sexual violence as such. So this is the award, Major Suman Gawani. Then next is Rozgar Setu for skilled workers in MP. So Madhya Pradesh Chief Minister Shivraj Singh Chauhan has announced the launch of Rozgar Setu scheme. So there is Arogya Setu scheme, which is actually an app for contact tracing, and this is Rozgar Setu scheme, which will help secure employment for skilled workers. So for unskilled workers, we have NREGA, Mahatma Gandhi National Rural Employment Guarantee Act, but for skilled workers, this is a scheme which the state government has initiated, which is the first by any state in the country. And in this, employment will be given, so means workers who will register under it, like they can be of various sectors. So based on their requirements, then government will contact factory, workshop owners, contractors for infrastructure projects, etc., and connect them. So it will act as a setu, means a bridge connecting them. Also, the Chief Minister of Madhya Pradesh appreciated central government Swamitva Yojana. So this is a scheme in under which rural areas would be surveyed to help repair land records. So we'll see about this scheme too. So Swamitva Yojana actually has been launched on National Panchayati Raj Day on a pilot basis in 6 states in 2019. It will map rural inhabited land through drones and new technology, and titles will be issued on the basis of this mapping. So people can be provided property rights. So property disputes in rural areas can be settled, and will help in revenue collection and planning too. Then next is Trump order targets social networks. So a day after US President Donald Trump lashed out on Twitter for fact checking two of his tweets on mail-in ballots. So he had criticized mail-in ballots, and Twitter put a fact check below his Twitter saying that the statements given are not correct. So that was highlighted. So on this, President Trump had become furious, and he had said that he will look into how social networking sites can be regulated. And now he has signed an executive order asking his administration to look into ways of holding social media platforms liable for content they carry. So actually, there is a law, Communications Decency Act of 1996 in USA, and Section 230 of it is one which provides these companies, American telecom, American technology companies, social media platforms like Facebook and Twitter, they have grown because these social media sites can carry third party content without being liable for all of it. Some exceptions are there, like they cannot carry, those which go against federal criminal laws or sex trafficking, intellectual property. So such exceptions are there, but otherwise they are not liable for third party content. So now President Trump wants them to be liable. So he has asked the Federal Communications Commission of USA to re-examine how protections granted under Section 230 can apply. So some modifications should be done so that they can be held liable. So the statute Section 230 also says that platform shall not be liable for actions taken in good faith to restrict material also. If any material is restricted, then they cannot be taken action against. So that's what Twitter has also done, like restriction or at least fact checking, which it did. So this is there. Also, US President Trump in his executive order has directed federal government agencies to review the amount of advertising dollars spent on online platforms. The revenue which government provides through its advertisings to various social media platforms like Facebook and Twitter. So that also should be reviewed, is what US President says now. So this is Section 230 of Communication Decency Act of 1996 of USA. Then next is Twitter conceals president's tweet for glorifying violence. So US President Donald Trump signed this executive order a day later after Twitter fact-checked, and hours after that, again Twitter actually moderated President Trump's tweet. So one of the tweets was covered with a notice for violating a rule of Twitter. Twitter said that this tweet of President Trump is glorifying violence. President Trump's tweet was actually regarding this African American person, George Floyd, who was killed by he was unarmed and he was killed by a white police officer. So because of this, there are protests going on. And President Trump tweeted that these thugs are dishonoring the memory of George Floyd and I will not let that happen. Just spoke to governor, this is in Minneapolis where this took place. So he spoke to the governor there and told him that the military is with him in all ways. And any difficulty, if he finds any difficulty, we will assume control. He says when the looting starts, the shooting starts. Thank you. So this is President Trump's tweet about the riots in Minneapolis. So this last line, looting starts, shooting starts, means if the people start protesting and looting, then the government will start shooting. So Twitter said that this tweet violates a policy regarding glorification of violence based on historical context of the last line. So earlier two such actions have taken place and this has resulted in violence. So that is why Twitter has put a notice on this tweet of Trump. So after clicking the notice, you can actually see President Trump's tweet. It has not been removed, but a notice has been placed on it. White House, that is US administration as such, it defended President Trump, saying that he did not glorify violence and retweeted the post, but Twitter covered the retweet also with the same notice. Then next is UK moots 5G club to keep Huawei. So Britain has now said that it is pushing countries including USA to form a D10 club. What is this D10? Club of 10 democratic nations. So they could develop its own 5G technology and reduce dependence on Huawei, which is a Chinese company. So this D10 means G7 nations will be included, means excluding Russia and the group of 7 developed nations, and also include Australia and the two Asian giants, that is South Korea and India. So Britain has allowed Chinese global leader in 5G technology to build up to 35% of the infrastructure necessary to roll out 5G data network. But then Prime Minister of UK, Boris Johnson, has reportedly instructed officials to draw plans to cut Huawei out of the network by 2023 because relations with China are soaring. So they are becoming sore. So this is there. And now D10 has been proposed. Also, how this will work is investments can be channeled into existing telecom companies within these 10 member nations is one of the options put forth to exclude Huawei. So this is it. So you can see these are the G7 nations: UK, France, Canada, US, Japan, Germany. So these are the three nations here. That is Australia, India, and South Korea. And this is Italy. So these are seven group of seven nations, and these are three addition which come to D10. Then next is fiscal deficit at 4.6% for financial year 2020 as revenue sags. So country's fiscal deficit has widened to 4.6% of GDP. So fiscal deficit, you should understand, is the total borrowing requirement of the government. There's a deficit between receipts and expenditure. So there's a gap between government revenue and expenditure, and this is because of shortfall in revenue, because poor revenue realization has been seen. Expenditure has actually been less than what was projected. You can see it was projected 26.98 lakhs, but government spent 26.86 lakhs. But revenue receipts as such have been very low. And the Controller General of Accounts data also showed that revenue receipts during the year worked out to be only 90% of the revised estimates. So already they were put down and now it is only 90% of that. The government received only 17.5 lakh crores as against 19.31 lakh crores which was estimated. The fiscal deficit has increased. So center's target was 3.8% and it has come to 4.6%. That will put pressure on the government further to now. Then next is core sector output contracts 38% in April. So the lockdown imposed due to COVID-19 pandemic has resulted in core sector output contracting. Means it is in the negative. Core sectors, eight core sectors which are there part of the index of industrial production. The eight core sectors actually form a 40% of the weight in IIP also. So the IIP would also crash is likely. So in the second straight month now, eight core sectors growth has been in the negative territory. Means they are not expanding, they are actually contracting. So minus 9 was its value in March 2020 and now it is minus 38% in April 2020. Also, contraction as such, which has been seen in cement production, it is minus 86%. Steel sector is minus 84%. And other sectors also, you can see only sector which has been least affected is fertilizer and crude oil, which saw a decline but at a lesser rate, minus 4.5 and minus 6.4%. Petroleum refinery products is the largest component in the eight core sectors. It shrank 24%. So that is there. So here you can see the detail is also given. So overall minus 38%, and you can see all are in the negative. Steel and cement have drastically gone down. In March only coal was in the positive, now coal is also in the negative. And as a percentage, when we saw that refinery products have maximum weightage, so in eight core sectors you can see maximum weightage of 28.04% is for refineries. Then comes electricity at 19.85%. Then steel at 17.92, coal at 10.33, crude oil at 8.98%, cement at 5.37, natural gas 6.88, cement 5.37, and least weightage is for fertilizers at 2.63%. So these are the eight core sectors and their weightage in the eight core sector. And overall their weightage in IIP is 40%. Then next is Telecom Regulator Moot's National Numbering Plan. So TRAI, Telecom Regulatory Authority of India, has recommended a new national numbering plan to be issued at the earliest so that a uniquely identifiable number can be provided to every subscriber in India. So we have a 10-digit mobile number. What it is proposing is switching to an 11-digit mobile number, like prefixing a 0 to all mobile numbers from fixed lines, to calls made from fixed lines as such too. So that adequately numbers are available, because number of subscribers are increasing greatly, and this is threatening because increase in the range of services and massive growth in number of connections, especially in the mobile segment, will make this system presently the 10-digit mobile number unsustainable. So total number of mobile phone subscribers, it is said telephone subscribers in India is 1,77.02 million. Tele density is 87.45%. So this is the proposal, an 11-digit mobile number. Then next is, also the 11-digit mobile number will actually have its complications. So TRAI has said it should be adopted only when there is no other way. So that is there, because then further many changes will have to be made to adapt this 11-digit mobile number to, in terms of technology. Then last news is, Sun Pharma gets nod for drug trial in COVID-19 patients. So Sun Pharmaceutical Industries Limited has announced that it has received the approval of Drugs Controller General of India, DCGI, to initiate clinical trial of nafamostat mesylate in COVID-19 patients. So nafamostat is actually approved in Japan for improvement of acute symptoms of pancreatitis and treatment of disseminated intravascular coagulation. So also another study as such in by University of Tokyo and Germany, and also study in South Korea, has shown that treatment of nafamostat treatment actually at very low concentrations, means you don't even have to give a high dose of nafamostat, it suppresses a protein that COVID-19 viruses use to enter human lung cells. So this seems to be promising, and some pharmaceutical wants to conduct drug trials, and Drug Controller General of India has given approval for this. So this is regarding South Korean study, which is studying antiviral efficacy of 24 drugs, and in that nafamostat seems to be the most potent drug. So that is there. So here you can see this is Sun Pharma getting DCGI nod for initial clinical trial with nafamostat in COVID-19 patients. So that is it. Thank you.